We now return to our tour of Fort Sumter, brought to you by the good folks over at Minier Ball, packing heat since 1849.
Hi, my name's Todd, and I'll be your tour guide for today. I'm standing directly outside of Fort Sumter in Charleston, South Carolina, one of the two remaining Union forts in the Southern Territories. The fort was named after General Thomas Sumter, a hero of the American Revolution and a longtime member of Congress of the United States. Now, if you'll just follow me, I'll give you some general information about the fort's structures. Fort Sumter was built after the War of 1812 as one of a series of fortifications on the southern United States coast. The construction, beginning in 1829, consisted of
Pardon the interruption, but I've just received word that Fort Sumter, a Union base located in South Carolina, has just been hit with an artillery strike from the Confederate Army. Newly inaugurated President Lincoln was attempting to supply food to hungry northern prisoners inside the fort. This attack is believed to have been initiated by Jefferson Davis, president of the newly formed Confederacy. If this is the case, I believe this may be the beginning of something big, folks. Something big. This attack could lead to a civil war within our precious nation. More news as it arrives. We go now to Ferguson at the scene of the attack. Ferguson, what do you believe led to the Confederate attack on Fort Sumter?
Well, I don't know, man. I don't know, man. It's just been crazy, man. It's just been crazy.
Thank you for that in-depth analysis, Ferguson. We now go to Mrs. Kelly with the head advisor of the Lincoln administration.
Thanks, Ron. I'm here with Sarah Green, and she's going to talk with us about the start of the Civil War. Well, we all know this war did not begin overnight. It's been a long-time struggle between two major belief groups in the United States that's ended in this conflict. However, if you look at the facts, the war actually began at Fort Sumter in Charleston Harbor. And if you will recall, Union troops were holding the fort when the Confederacy demanded a surrender.
Is it true that Lincoln was presented with a dilemma early in the war?
Yes, Lincoln's leadership has been tested from the very start of his presidency. A very short 2 days after his inauguration, he received word from General Anderson inside the fort that he must make a decision about supplies.
Can you elaborate on this decision?
As I said earlier, the Union was trying to maintain their hold on the fort, because obviously it's not very good to have a Union fort in the state that is first to succeed. Lincoln could shoot the Navy into the harbor, or he could neglect the fort of all supplies and give a surrender.
What are the political consequences of this action?
Sending the Navy into the harbor as an act of aggression against the South looks horrible politically. This makes it look as if Lincoln wants this war. However, surrendering is just as bad. This action treats the Confederacy as an independent nation and will make the North look weak before the war even has a chance to begin.
So, which path does Lincoln take?
This is what I love about Abraham Lincoln. He doesn't pick either of these solutions, and he looks marvelous politically. He keeps the pride of the North intact and keeps the border states with the Union by simply giving the fort enough food and items necessary for survival, but not giving them weapons. By doing this, he has now put the responsibility on Davis. If Davis chooses to revoke the surrender, he loses the image of the Confederacy as a sovereign nation capable of holding their own, so to speak. But if he does attack the fort, he loses all hope of a peaceful succession from the Union.
I see. Well, we're almost out of time, but what decision does Davis make?
Well, Davis attacked Fort Sumter on April 12th, and Charleston citizens cheered as 4,000 rounds were fired in the harbor. Then, as we all recall, Anderson gives a surrender from the inside of the fort, and the war officially begins. Lincoln has recently called up 75,000 men to serve a three-month duty. I've also received word that North Carolina, Virginia, Arkansas, and Tennessee have issued articles of secession so they too can join the Confederacy.
We will certainly keep up with this story. Thank you for your time. Welcome back to WXCW News at 11. In tonight's Civil War special, we bring you special guest Mr. Walton. Mr. Walton and I will be discussing the recent release of controversial novel Uncle Tom's Cabin by Harriet Beecher Stowe. The book recounts the journey of a black slave named Tom as he is sold to masters in three different states, including Kentucky, Louisiana, and Arkansas. Good afternoon, Mr. Walton. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here, ma'am.
You reside in one of the five so-called border states, am I correct?
Baltimore, Maryland, to be exact. Sure gets cold up there, ma'am. My family and I like to never made it through last winter.
Mr. Walton, what was your view of slavery before Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel?
Well, I never thought much about slavery for the most part. It just wasn't a big issue in my life. My family didn't own any slaves, and the only people I knew who did were my neighbors and some of my friends. I'd just see old man Robert in the fields with his slaves and didn't think twice about it. Slavery was just a part of my life, and it never bothered me at all that my neighbors owned other people.
Completely understandable, Mr. Walton. Why did you refrain from owning any slaves for your own family?
I just didn't see the need in having to pay an arm and a leg to buy another person to do the hard work that I'm fully capable of doing for myself. I would maybe see owning slaves for work on a big plantation, well, that is, before reading Uncle Tom's Cabin.
I see. Now, after having read the book, what is your view on the history of slavery within the United States?
The book has significantly changed my feelings on the issue, ma'am. I went from indifferent to emotional overnight, so to speak. Even after reading of the hardships faced by Uncle Tom throughout his journey, a man like myself cannot even begin to imagine the troubles these people had to face. Slavery ain't just the ownership and use of property. Oh no, Mrs. Kelly. Slavery is an outright crime against mankind. A cardinal sin, I'd go as far to say. Our Constitution tells us that all men were created equal in the eyes of God, so why must some be treated as caged dogs and others as kings? It ain't right, I tell you. I know there are others that feel the same way I do, and I know there's some that'll try their hardest to do something about it. If nothing's resolved on this issue soon, I'm fairly certain that this could lead to nothing less than an outright war within the nation. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you for your time, Mr. Walton. In other news...
But, before entering upon the argument, I must say something of general character, particularly in response to what has fallen from senators who have raised themselves to eminence on the floor and championship of human realms. I mean, the senator from South Carolina and the senator from Illinois, who, though unlike Don Quixote and Sancho Panza, yet, like this couple, sally forth together in the same adventure. I regret much to miss the elder senator from his seat, but the cause against which he has run a tilt, which such activity of animosity demands that the opportunity of exposing him should not be lost. And it is for the cause that I speak. The senator from South Carolina has read many books of chivalry and declares himself a chivalrous knight, with sinumcuts of honor and courage. Of course, he has chosen a mistress to whom he has made his vows, and who, though ugly to others, is always lovely to him. Though polluted in the sight of the world, is chaste in his sight, I mean, the harlot, slavery.
So I was just sitting there and listening to that crazy speech of his, and dude, he called my wife a harlot.
Don't worry, cousin. I got just a thing for this creep.
I don't believe you had an appointment. Can I help you?